Today we're going to be working on a wolf's nose. I know, a very realistic wolf's nose. I'm going to show you how to paint that using watercolour. Let's get started. Hi, I'm Paul Hopkinson and I'm a professional watercolour wildlife artist. Now, time to make a start on this. Got to get a little bit of water on the nose first of all and allow that water to soak into the paper as well. By the way, I'm using a size 5 brush. This is one by Rosemary & Co, series 93. Quite a nice one to work with, actually. It's a very short bristled brush as well, so it's not got very long bristles. So it kind of helps me control them bristles and that brush as I start applying the paint onto the paper. Now, Payne's Grey is one of those colours where a lot of people use it for part of a dark colour, don't they? When you mix it with browns and reds, it's kind of a nice kind of dark mix. I use it very often for background colour because Payne's Grey, because it's got the blue in it, tends to feel more of a receding colour for me. So using it quite watery to begin with for the background wash does help that. Always allow it to blend into the white of the paper above the nose. And that's because you've got to think about all the fine hairs that's coming down from the bridge of the nose and just about touching that nose. You want them to blend together. And then doing so will allow you to kind of blend those fine hairs for the fur, for those initial layers together, and allow it to blend just onto the edge of the nose without that looking too sharp. Then we can go in with a slightly darker mix, and we've got to think about the shape, initial shape. So these are just those foundation washes, remember, just those background colours, which we'll start building all the detail up on top of later on. So you've got to get these background colours in first of all, and this will kind of help you sort of create the shape initially, okay? Sort of semi-seals the paper in as well, I find, with all this colour on the paper. So when you start to add the details over the top, you find that this colour will help those details stand out as well. And you've also got to think about the warmth. So a little bit of kind of warm colour, like a alizarin crimson or something like that within the mix. And when you start adding that alizarin crimson in, you've got that kind of warm feel to the bottom of the nose. So now this is nice and dry, let's start mapping things out. Because what you've got to think about when you're working on the mapping stage is you've got to be as accurate as you can be. Because this mapping out process will help you decide on the shapes, the angles, the sizes as well, and also the fine details which you can start adding around this mapping out edge. You've got to consider the colour you're using to map out with as well. This is fine on the nose because it's going to be quite dark around this side of the nose anyway, especially obviously inside the nostrils. But you also need to keep looking at that reference photograph as well, because the more you look backward and forward at that reference photograph, the more you tend to remember the shapes, the angles, etc. when you start working on this. Now don't forget to click on subscribe and like down below, and also leave a comment as well. I'd love to hear from you. Now I very often fill the nostrils in when I'm working on the nose first, not all the time though, but in this case let's go from light with the kind of foundation washes first and then the dark nostrils. And this is going to give us more of a contrasting colour. Now I've switched to my size 00 brush, and this is where I can start to add in some stipples and some marks. And you're going to build these up gradually throughout the painting process. Because the idea behind all this, you start off with like a very pale colour first of all, thinking about the tonal variations within a painting, and then gradually building these colours up as you go along. So it's all through stippling. A bit like, well, pointillism really, isn't it? You know, the old master's way of painting sometimes. Painting with lots and lots of little tiny dots, okay? And you can see as you gradually build up these dots, you gradually start adding more dots closer together. Then you can start to form the shape of the nose. So even just at the top of the nostril here, where I'm starting to darken this by adding more dots in there, you can now start to see the shape and the feel of the top part of this nose. And that's starting to come together. So you've got to look at the density of the lines as well, and also the size of the marks, because they make a massive difference when you're working on this. Allow some of those lighter marks as well to show through, because you need all the kind of really pale areas to still stand out. And when you look at that reference photograph, you can see there's more to the top left-hand side of the nose, can't you? You know, it's a little bit paler, where we've got that Payne's Grey, as you now know, in the background at the top of the nose. We still need to add a little few kind of very fine darks in there as well. Some very fine little tiny taps as we work on that. Now, when you look to the very top of the nose, you can see I very lightly, added a few small marks as well, blending into where the fur starts. All right, see the idea? So when we start adding the fur over the top of that, we then know that that's going to semi-blend together. It's not going to be kind of two-toned. It's not going to be just where one thing starts and another thing finishes and so on. We want a bit of a happy kind of slight blend there. Working your way down the nose, you've now got to think about the main shape when you're working in there. So going through the center of the nose is fine, but really very often at the bottom of the nose, it can be very dark as well. But you've got to remember, I tend to use watercolor white. And because I use watercolor white, I like to kind of add some of the highlights around there. And we can see on that reference photograph, as you can very well see to the right-hand side of the screen, there's a lot of light in there, isn't there, on the under part of the nose. So unusually, with this nose, compared to plenty of dogs' noses I've painted in the past, believe you may have painted a lot of dogs' noses, this is one which is unusual because normally it's darker at the bottom of the nose and lighter towards the top. So something a little bit different, really, the way this is all kind of forming and going together. So now we're going to very, very lightly soften some of the areas, still using that size 00 brush. But I'm looking at some of the blending inside the nostril. I don't want a really hard edge on the right-hand side as it goes into the depths of that deep nostril there. So very lightly blend it and gradually move it around. And I'm adding very fine details now. Now, when I load my size 00 brush up, I tend to think about, I load it, roll it into your mixing palette as you would normally do, roll it away up the side of that mixing palette, then tap it once or twice, very lightly, very, very lightly, on some kitchen roll. By doing that, you'll end up with a finer point to work with as well, and you're not going to be putting a very large blob of paint onto that paper when you do so. Now, another little tip I can give you as well, try half closing your eyes. What do you mean, Paul? I won't be able to say anything. Yes, you will, you will. Try half closing your eyes when you look at the reference photograph, and you find that when you do that, then you'll be able to see the contrast and the tonal variations very often within a photograph. Time for using watercolor white. Now, when I'm using watercolor white, you've got to think about the consistency of the white. It can be tricky to get right sometimes, I know. You've got to make sure, first of all, that the watercolor white or white gouache, whichever you're going to use, is going to be of a creamy nature and also an opaque medium. It's certainly got to be opaque, because sometimes you find some white paints tend to be semi-opaque. So therefore, they show the colours through, which we don't always want to happen. What we need to happen is for the white paint to be able to be controlled in the sense of so it really covers everything up and also shows things through. What do you mean, Paul? What I mean by that is that by adding a little bit more water to the white paint, you can tone it down. You can have it dry so it's just very pale. And you can still see some of the colours and details underneath that as well. So trying to get that consistency right, which is very, very important when you're working with white paint. So don't overdo it as well. So when you're adding white paint on, it can be very easy, believe me, I've done it more than once. You can then kill that colour underneath. Be careful. Always add less than you think you'll need, okay? So you can always walk away, go make a cup of coffee, come back with fresh eyes, and then view it again and decide at that point if you want to add some more white in or not. Now, if you have added too much white, or if some of the white is a little bit too stark, a little bit too bright, you can add a little bit of colour over the top. And all you do is simply do that by one fell swoop, only one fell swoop, of watercolour, whatever colour you decide to add over the top, very, very lightly. Then let it dry. If you need to add more, then go over the top again with the same colour or another colour if you want to in one very light pass. Now, if you would like to see more of this wolf being painted, head to the video on the right and I'll see you there. Have you painted an animal's nose recently? Be it a dog, a cat, a squirrel, even a little ant? No, probably not an ant. Pop a comment down below and let me know what breed and what animal that is.